Senewiratne, and I'm a medical doctor. I'm making this film to present some research that I have done, and presenting it in a somewhat unorthodox fashion, perhaps. The research that I've been doing has been over the past 3 years and started off as research into psychiatry. Subsequently, I was looking for the causes behind the causes of illness, illness generally, and subsequently started looking at the marketing of various illnesses and the possible creation of illnesses. This particular search was in balance to work that I was doing on health and the importance of the mind-body relationship and thinking in a healthy way and happiness, etc., as promoters of good health. At the same time, my research into the more disturbing sides of medicine and science are very important and serious matters, I believe, and this is why I have made this film, or why I'm making this film. Some of the research that I'm presenting in this short film is here within a folder, and it's talking about AIDS and the source of AIDS. My journey to discovering or researching sources or the cause of AIDS came perhaps from a circuitous route. I was researching eugenics as part of the background theory of modern psychiatry, and I noticed a similarity between the targets of eugenics being blacks, the poor, indigenous people, morally depraved people as they were viewed, etc. I noticed a similarity between those traditional targets who were targeted during Hitler's genocidal regime in Nazi Germany, a similarity between those populations and the populations that happened to be getting AIDS at the moment. And I noticed some inconsistencies in terms of what I was taught at medical school, or in the hospitals really. When I was in medical school, when I graduated in 1983, AIDS had only just been discovered. I noticed a discrepancy between information I received through my medical education on a postgraduate level, and things that I was reading elsewhere in the press, as well as a some difficult questions that I had to ask about where medical science and science research and practice had been heading for many decades. This was looking at the history of biological warfare, chemical warfare, population control, and other areas that people were mentioning could have something to do with AIDS. I went looking to find the truth. My research into AIDS started with my research into psychiatry and my research into eugenics, which is part of the history of psychiatry. Selling illness makes a lot of money, and wars also make a lot of money for a small number of people. The marketing of chemicals is closely tied in with the history of warfare, and chemical warfare has been used against indigenous people as well as the population of countries that develop the chemical warfare agents themselves, the civil population.
The medical press has been relatively silent on the origin of AIDS. And questions have been asked about whether AIDS could be, have been introduced intentionally as either a biological warfare agent or population control measure. Paul Ehrlich, who wrote The Population Bomb, was one of the writers in the 1960s and 1970s, and later in the 1980s, who have continued to increase concern about overpopulation in the world, which is largely blamed on the Third World, Africa in particular, and India, Southeast Asia. These happen to be areas with high and rising incidences of AIDS. Other coincidences need to be explained. This folder is a folder on biological warfare, compiled by a doctor who has no formal history in the training of biological warfare. It merely requires an analysis of how medical science and science generally, biological science, can be used to create illness and death rather than healing people. AIDS is believed to be caused by the HIV virus, although a small number of academics in America, such as Peter Duisberg, are disputing this claim. I have little reason to doubt that HIV is the major viral causative factor in the development of AIDS. However, the theory that HIV entered the human population from monkeys in Africa defies the observations of modern epidemiology. These statistics are from Harrison's Principles of Internal Medicine, 13th edition. It is interesting to note what information is included in this textbook, which is a major medical specialist textbook. The contributors to Harrison's Principles of Internal Medicine are over 200 professors of medicine, largely American. The emphasis on the information, of the information, is largely on AIDS in America, and focus on AIDS as a homosexual illness. However, the global distribution of AIDS does not suggest a homosexual illness at all. Most AIDS sufferers are in Africa, sub-Saharan Africa, where AIDS is a heterosexual disease, largely affecting children and young women. This is the same pattern of AIDS that appears to be causing an epidemic in New Guinea. In America and Australia and Europe, Western Europe, AIDS is largely a homosexual disease and one that is transmitted by IV drug use and the sharing of needles. This is what we are told. A major emphasis on prevention of AIDS is on free distribution of needles for heroin users and other IV drug users in Australia. There are some important questions that need to be asked about the wisdom of such programs. The doctrine that is being promoted by the medical establishment is that once a person has the HIV virus or is exposed to the HIV virus and produces antibodies, AIDS is an inevitable consequence, even though the development of AIDS may be delayed by up to 20 years. There is an obvious contradiction in this, since AIDS was first discovered in 1984, so 20 years has not yet elapsed since the first discovery of AIDS. The HIV antibody test merely measures antibodies against AIDS. This is not an indicator that the person has AIDS. It means that the person has successfully fought off the HIV virus, or may have done. The body's producing an effective immune response against HIV. Antibody production by lymphocytes is an indication that the lymphocytes are functioning in the way that they are supposed to. An HIV antigen, or the HIV virus, is a completely different thing from an HIV antibody. There are many things that depress the immune system in addition to the HIV virus. Stress is one of them. Alan Cantwell has had several articles published in the independent news press about AIDS and the theories of its origin. The most strongly promoted theory by the medical establishment and the universities in Australia is the green monkey theory, that AIDS spread into the African population, the black heterosexual population in Africa in the 1970s, from green monkeys, perhaps through a bite, and possibly through sexual contact. This article says Isberg is one who has questioned whether or not AIDS is caused by the HIV virus, but very few doctors would support his hypothesis. The correspondence between HIV virus infection and AIDS is, in my view, unquestionable. However, the source of the HIV virus in Africa and in America does not appear to be the same. There are several myths published in the alternative and independent press, some more ridiculous than others. Some require some serious consideration because they're making some very serious allegations. The link between AIDS and psychiatry is evident in medical information that is sent around to general practitioners and sent to doctors to educate them about AIDS and patients with AIDS, fear of AIDS. As well as those who have actually developed AIDS. The connection between an AIDS infection and psychiatric illness goes further than the diagnosis of depression. AIDS is being associated with mania. A feature of the psychiatric diagnosis of mania is paranoia, a suggestion that AIDS could be man-made, would be considered by psychiatrists or by many psychiatrists to be itself evidence of paranoia and could easily be dismissed as being a feature of mental illness associated with HIV or AIDS infection. University research in Melbourne focuses largely on sexual behavior and intravenous drug use. In terms of risk factors for the development of AIDS, there's a close link between AIDS research and hepatitis research. Spearheading the research in AIDS and hepatitis is the McFarlane-Burnett Institute in Melbourne. The McFarlane-Burnett Institute is named after a prominent Melbourne Victorian immunologist. And AIDS drugs and AIDS research have been for many years major drug spinners and profit spinners for drug companies. Alan Cantwell is a doctor in America who has written several articles about the man-made theory. The McFarlane-Burnett Institute does not mention such theories. It instead assumes the green monkey theory to be true. This brochure was provided by the McFarlane-Burnett Institute for the general public as information about AIDS. It states that AIDS is caused by the HIV virus. This is hardly contentious. However, the claim that an HIV infection inevitably will cause AIDS, or exposure and the development of HIV antibodies, is necessarily a precursor to a death from AIDS, or that HIV is a very complicated virus with an unusual structure, and similar rather vague claims and misleading claims in this brochure require some questions to be asked, I believe. The assumption that when the virus infects you, it's there for life, and that the course of the infection is incredibly prolonged, a part of a doctrine that is widely promoted to the medical establishment and by the medical establishment.
Doctors, however, teach what doctors are taught to teach, and few doctors are taught about biological warfare or the history of biological warfare. In America and in Europe, as well as in Russia and in India, a number of doctors have expressed the belief that AIDS was man-made. Many have pointed out the similarity between the HIV virus and known viruses in animals, on which genetic engineering and viral experimentation has been occurring for many decades now. Fort Detrick in Bethesda, Maryland, is one of the most long-standing centers of biological research, which has been tied in with biological warfare research and military research. However, with the official closing of biological warfare departments in the early 1970s, biological warfare research moved into private institutions, private universities, and also in government-run institutions in Australia, in England, in America, and also in Switzerland, Germany, Japan. The hepatitis B vaccination campaign in America amongst the homosexual population in the 1970s has been blamed by a number of researchers for the introduction of AIDS into this population. The correspondence between vaccination rates for hepatitis B in this campaign and the development of AIDS in the same population cannot be denied. Many myths have circulated about the origin of AIDS in the homosexual population, but there is no doubt that homophobia is rife in particular sections of the community. Homosexuals have been traditionally viewed as morally depraved by eugenicists and targeted by campaigns of euthanasia and forced sterilization in Nazi Germany and other repressive regimes. Africa has been targeted by many abuses, exploitation, and slavery for centuries now. The initial cases of AIDS in Africa were all from Central Africa: Zaire, Zambia, Tanzania, Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi, Congo, and the Central African Republic. These happen to be the areas in which smallpox and polio eradication campaigns occurred in the 1960s and 1970s. The polio vaccines were made from vaccine grown on monkey kidneys. The smallpox vaccine and the polio vaccine have been implicated as possibly accidentally introducing AIDS and perhaps other infections into the African population. The argument that the reason that new viruses have appeared in Africa in such numbers, such as Ebola virus and Marburg virus, the argument that this is due to the chopping down of forests in Africa and the release of normal animals that have been in the wild coming into contact with the human population simply does not make sense, given that far greater tracts of forest are being chopped down in South America and the Amazon without the appearance of these same plagues. The preparedness of the senior members of the medical fraternity in Australia to answer questions and allay concerns about AIDS policies as well as the source of AIDS and the possible link with the immunization campaign that is so strongly pushed by the Australian government, the Australian medical community, as well as the American, as well as the British medical establishments. Has been noticeable. Coincidence that AIDS affects the same populations on which euthanasia and human experimentation and forced sterilization have occurred in the past to me raises many questions. The enthusiasm with which the green monkey theory is pushed by the medical establishment itself leads some questions to be asked. There is no doubt that AIDS in Africa has made a lot of money for a small number of companies, and much of the treatment is geared and aimed towards the provision of zidovudine, or AZT, an antiviral drug that is marketed by GlaxoWelcome, a multinational drug company that also market in Australia morphine. Drug warfare has a long history, and the British government have been involved in drug warfare for several centuries now. The opium wars in China are well known and undeniable, and during this time it's important to note that the British government attempted to convince the British people that the opium wars had nothing to do with opium and were merely to do with free trade. The World Health Organization is the primary source of information about AIDS, and the information that is provided by the WHO is generally accepted without questioning. The McFarlane Burnett Institute as the Centre of AIDS Research in Australia, is also accepted as a credible authority on AIDS. This article suggesting that the sexual practices of New Guinean men were the reason behind AIDS developing as an epidemic in New Guinea. But an epidemic affecting mainly young women aged between 17 and 25 reeks of prejudice. And it's very unconvincing. This is from the publicity brochure of the Macfarlane Burnet Institute, giving some indication of the extent of vaccination promotion tied in with AIDS research that is being conducted by this large organization. The government and the universities in Australia are closely working with the Macfarlane Burnet Centre. The focus of the research is on AIDS in psychiatric patients, in Aboriginals, and a focus on the sexual habits of young Australians. Glaxo Wellcome produces AZT, and this is being marketed as the benchmark drug for AIDS. However, the medical press recommend that monotherapy is no longer appropriate, and several drugs should be used at the same time. There is no doubt that these drugs are highly toxic and many fatalities occur because of the drugs. Frequently, the news media announce enthusiastically that there has been a new development in AIDS treatment, and the new development is almost always a new drug. The connection between the traditional targets of eugenics, the marketing of eugenics under new guises and using new euphemisms, has been one of the topics of research of the Holistic Research and Information Center. There is no doubt that if it is a coincidence, the coincidence is extraordinary, that these modern plagues should be affecting the same populations that have been targeted only 50 years ago by Nazi euthanasia campaigns, and that euthanasia is again being popularized by a number of doctors in Australia and America. The marketing of antidepressants and the marketing of melatonin are part of the psychiatric push for marketing hormones and neurohormones and drugs that affect them. Another side of psychiatric theory is to provide a psychiatric and supposedly medically and scientifically valid justification for the taking of drugs. Whilst alcohol and tobacco are recognized to be big killers, psychiatric drugs are not as widely recognized as such. However, there is no doubt that the incidence of suicide and the success of suicide from taking of tablets has greatly increased in the past 50 years, whilst countless millions of dollars have been spent supposedly preventing depression and suicide, spearheaded by the psychiatric establishment. Although ironically, psychiatrists have amongst the highest incidence of suicide themselves as a profession. AIDS is not the only mystery epidemic that appears to be ravaging Africa. Ebola virus and Marburg virus are two other viruses. There's no doubt that clean water and the promotion of breastfeeding are two of the most important things that could be done in Africa and the Third World to improve health. The requirement of drugs and the pushing of condoms and the scientific justification of condom studies by a virology institute.
The McFarland-Burnett Institute is also doing some studies on comparisons between condom standards in Australia and Switzerland, with apparently concerns that the Swiss SEAL standards were higher and more stringent than the Australian SEAL standards. But they found after testing several thousand condoms that the Australian SEAL standards were reasonable. This is the research of a specialist virology institute that is specializing in AIDS and hepatitis research. Many of the focuses of AIDS prevention are on the promotion of condoms and promotion of needle exchange programs. Both of them, of course, are supportive of the petrochemical industry that produce chemical as well as electrical goods. This includes metals, the mining industry, etc., the corporate structure, in other words. The other thing that's disturbing about the McFarland Institute brochure that was handed out for the public is the promotion of AZT. Now, even though I disagree with Peter Duesberg's theory that AIDS is not caused by the HIV virus, he's also suggested that full-blown AIDS is aggravated or perhaps caused by AZT. In view of that very serious concern, I think it's important to recognize that AZT certainly does cause immunosuppressive problems. That is how it works. It's a cytotoxic agent, and therefore it'll kill cells, and it kills immune cells as well. It's supposed to target the AIDS virus more particularly. However, there's no doubt that all cytotoxic drugs are very toxic drugs and kill cells and kill people as well. Likewise, cancer drugs that also are well known for their horrendous side effects. The idea that several cytotoxic drugs plus other antibiotics, antifungals, mood depressants, or mood elevators, etc., that they should all be used in conjunction with each other in the treatment of AIDS, being promoted by the medical industry, the pharmaceutical industry, as well as by the hospital system, certainly requires some questions to be asked. the idea that the third world is unable to afford the expensive AZT, which is produced by the British company, or now multinational company, Glaxo Wellcome. AZT is a very expensive drug, and most third world countries are told that they cannot afford it. At the same time, there is a black market demand for AZT, and likewise there are black market demands for any new curative trial drugs, etc., for AIDS. Hundreds of patents for new drugs and new vaccines, and the development of new vaccines are awaiting approval in America. In Australia, again, there is a great deal of research going into new drugs for AIDS. My own personal experience with AIDS is limited, and I've only had one patient who died of AIDS, who was in his mid-20s and was under the treatment at the same time of the Fairfield Infectious Diseases Hospital, which was the initial base of the McFarlane Burnet Institute. This patient was on about 12 to 15 different drugs at the same time, and this didn't stop him from dying of AIDS. He became somewhat obsessed by the disease as it progressed through his body, and this was not helped by a constant barrage of tablets. His whole day centered around the taking of his tablets and looking out for new signs of the progression of his disease. His psychological state as a result of it was being treated with antidepressants as well as sleeping tablets by the hospital doctors. This is not an uncommon situation, and the connection between psychiatry and AIDS has been promoted by the psychiatric profession as well as the medical profession. This is, to me, particularly interesting given the history of eugenics and the link between the populations that have been targeted with AIDS or are developing AIDS, the changing demographics of AIDS, and eugenics policy and theory, and a resurgence in actual eugenics science, disguised by euphemisms at times, but certainly the principles regarding the genetic labeling of schizophrenia as well as violence and alcoholism are all part of a tradition of eugenics, of labeling particular groups in society as being genetically defective. This is the principle behind eugenics, which is about the selective breeding of superior human beings. Now, the doctors and scientists who developed the ideas of superior human beings naturally considered themselves to be amongst the superior. They inevitably placed Aboriginal and people that they considered to be uncivilized and not city building, they considered them to be at the bottom of the hierarchy, somewhere above animals, or maybe around the same level at times. Certainly, they employed very, very brutal ways of killing these subhuman, as they viewed them, groups of people, more inhumane than anything that occurs in the animal kingdom. This included poisoning of their water supplies, hunting them with guns and shooting them, which of course occurred in Australia within this century, as well as infecting them deliberately with different infections. Smallpox is one that is well known, but there were a range of influenza wiped out many people in many millions in the Americas, and it was introduced. Whether it was introduced accidentally or introduced intentionally is a question that is quite uncomfortable for many people to face. The fact is that it was, at least on a number of occasions, introduced intentionally, and that is what biological warfare is. The link between attacking populations with infections and the demographics of a number of 20th century illnesses was something that both alarmed me and urged me to look deeper into what causes these 20th century illnesses, which are now the plagues of our planet. In terms of Australian society, depression is a major killer in our society and is predicted, interestingly, by the World Health Organization to increase along with other mental illness as a cause of disability and death in Australia. I am very concerned about this prediction, partly because I understand some of the forces that are leading to an increase in mental illness in our society. And this is the promotion of mental illness, promotion of the words, promotion of the drugs to treat them, and promotion of the factors that generate psychological distress, imagined fears, concerns, pessimistic and nihilistic beliefs, as well as the promotion of addiction. Addiction kills many people in our society, both addiction to food as well as addiction to alcohol, to tobacco, as well as addiction to other drugs, both pharmaceutical and illicit drugs. There is no doubt that the big people, as they say, behind drug pushing are not taken to court, they're not behind bars. I've known this for many years, probably decades now. It's always been a concept that I was familiar with, but it never occurred to me that drug pushing could be done by doctors. As a doctor myself, it never occurred to me that I was at any stage drug pushing when I urged people to take drugs, when I wouldn't have taken those drugs in exactly the same situation. Now, I feel very uncomfortable with the idea that during my 10 years in general practice, on occasion, I did do this. And I didn't fully explain to patients the full extent of the side effects and the possible side effects and the risks associated with drugs. I was encouraged in my training not to do this, in fact, that it would only alarm the patient and the patient wouldn't take the drug, as if that in itself was a desirable outcome. I have found this to be a consistent feature within modern medical training for doctors and for nurses. In the psychiatric system, an extraordinary amount of grossly untrue information is systematically and routinely given out to patients about the drugs, their side effects, and the necessity, which is compared with the necessity of a diabetic to receive insulin, for a schizophrenic to receive his drugs, which are neurotoxic drugs. It is quite extraordinary because this is a complete and utter fabrication. It is scientific fraud. And insulin in a diabetic is not life-saving and necessary in the vast number of diabetics, number one. Number two, psychiatry is nothing like metabolic endocrinology and endocrinology. Psychiatry is to do with naming a person as schizophrenic using criteria which are far, far more subjective than an elevated blood sugar level. There is no cure for schizophrenia that is promoted by psychiatry. There is no cure for schizophrenia for the simple reason that psychiatry will not allow schizophrenia to be cured. Schizophrenia is a psychiatric word. They treat people that they call schizophrenic. And they treat them with drugs which systematically poison them and kill them through damaging their nervous system. It causes tardive dyskinesia, causes Parkinson's syndrome, causes a lack of motivation, it causes psychosis itself, it causes stiffness, rigidity, a lack of creativity, emotional flatness. These are the same symptoms that they describe as the symptoms of chronic schizophrenia, or secondary negative symptoms. In other words, a person who develops schizophrenia is developing the very same symptoms that are known side effects of the drugs. Now, my answer to that is quite simple, that schizophrenia can be cured. And it can be cured simply by not accepting the label of schizophrenia. There is no doubt that madness exists in our society. There are many, many forms of madness. Greed and aggression are madness. It's mad to build nuclear bombs. It's mad to build landmines. So much of what goes on in Parliament is mad. If people behave like that in public, shouting at each other, it would be considered to be mad, and it is mad. The idea that particular groups of people that have been traditionally hunted as witches, or persecuted as heretics or revolutionaries or dissidents, that these same people should be targeted as particularly mad by the psychiatric profession, according to doctrines that are coming from America in an American textbook, which is constantly updated and changed every few years, seems to be quite anachronistic and very dangerous and destructive for Australia in the year 1998. We are 2 years away from the millennium, and it's time that people rejected prejudices and stereotypes and the entire basis of psychiatric labeling of particular people as genetically defective and chemically imbalanced is something that really needs to be questioned. In my opinion, it needs to be stopped, and people need to be counseled in a caring and helpful way. Individually, this can be done by a range of different psychological counselors who are focusing on positive messages, positive suggestions for people, and taking away destructive, negative and pessimistic labels which themselves kill people. Now, to me, I have no direct proof that AIDS was man-made. All I've done in this film is present some of my evidence and information that links AIDS with what I know is a promotion of eugenics by the medical establishment. I know also that drugs for the treatment of AIDS are being indiscriminately promoted, and I also know that condoms and milk powder and needles for injections and plastic and population control in what was considered to be a troublesome, a potential danger area for world population, all of these things are in some way being, you could say, assisted by AIDS. However, the horror of the idea that somebody could deliberately do that or deliberately exploit populations that have been traditionally for hundreds or thousands of years exploited, enslaved, raped and culturally destroyed, that these populations should again be targeted is quite horrific and something that is disturbing, and I'm sorry to have to present this information to anyone, but for me it's such an important issue that people do need to know about it so that it can be stopped, if it is true. So I hope that doctors and academics in particular will go looking at their professions and root out the destructive policies of eugenics from science, so that science can grow in a more holistic, generous, ethical and moral way. Thank you.